Welcome to today's lunchtime curator talk, which is an event for the Friends of the State Library of New South Wales. Before we begin, I'd like to acknowledge the traditional owners of the land on which I work and we're meeting, the Gadigal people of the Eora Nation. So I'm just going to start sharing my screen. Hoping that's all good. No, not sharing. Sorry, if you just bear a minute. Technical. Missed a click. How's that going now? Excellent, good. Well, after that hitch, we're going to join today to talk about an extraordinary voyage, which I had the pleasure of discovering in great detail recently. The library acquired this extraordinary set of beautifully illustrated logbooks, which were created by the Sydney marine artist Jack Earl to record a circumnavigation of the world that he undertook with four other crew between 1947 and 48. It was an 18-month voyage. The logbooks had been retained in the Earl family up until just before, I think it was about 2015, when the family donated them to the State Library. And we've now finally been able to digitise them. So they are now currently on display in the Amaze Gallery. So in preparing the logbooks for display, I was tasked with actually delving in, turning each of the pages and trying to make that very difficult choice as to what would go on display. So the story of the Kathleen Gillett, which is the name of the boat and the circumnavigation of the world, is really a love story. So next. Are we going? Help. Uh-oh, we're not moving. Why are we not moving? Sorry. There we go. Excellent. Good. Sorry about that. We'll get all these technical hitches out of the way. So Jack Earl was a Sydney man. He was a sailor and he was also a graphic artist. He had left school at quite a young age and was working as an illustrator for newspapers like The Truth and various other publications in Sydney. But one of his real passions was the sea. And he'd always sailed, always, messed around in boats, as they say. And it was after he met his future wife, Kathleen, in the 1930s, that it actually became the couple's dream to create a yacht for that they would be able to sail around the world in. And this became their project for the next 9 years. They sunk every penny that they had. They were obviously a young working couple, and they put all their money into the creation of the boat. It was an ocean-going vessel. It was always intended to be an ocean-going vessel, but it was very carefully designed for a long haul trip, because it had been the intention that Kathleen and Jack would sail the world together. Unfortunately, the war intervened, and by the time they were able to think again about sailing the boat around the world, they had two children. And also, so I'll just show you some pictures. There we go. So this is the family, Jack's family. There were Michael and Maris. Michael was born in 1935, and Maris, a couple of years later. And the family actually lived on the boat at Mossman while it was being fitted out, because they didn't actually have anywhere else to live. And during the Second World War, there were lots of restrictions on housing. So they all lived on the boat. And there's a fantastic article in one of the newspapers, city newspapers, which is... they've attracted a bit of attention because people coming down to the ferry at Mossman saw this family, you know, living on the boat, and they saw Kathleen, you know, pegging out the washing on the line, and the kids, you know, kissing the kids as they went off to school. So it became a bit of a common interest story, and it's a fantastic article. So I do encourage you to go onto Trove and just type that in, Kathleen Gillett and Kathleen Earl, and you'll get the story. You'll be able to read that for yourselves. The couple that were living on the boat with the children, and that was when they were fitting it out. So it had already been built, but they were, you know, making it comfortable. It was really a very cozy home. And you can see up the top the image here of Kathleen in her bunk reading a book. And, you know, it really does give you that sense of coziness. And as I say, the plan was that the family would be taking this voyage together. But there we go. As I say, the war intervened, and by the time the war was over, the children were in high school, and Kathleen had been a teacher, so she was very focused on their education, and so she really didn't want them to miss out on school. And so it was decided, it was a very difficult decision for Kathleen and Jack, that they that Jack alone would go with a crew of four other sailors. And to test the boat out, he and some friends decided that it might be an idea to stage an ocean going event. So they put together the idea for the first Sydney to Hobart yacht race. And so you can see on this screen that the map that is there was a souvenir map that was produced at the time, and that's actually designed by Jack Earl. Now, I used this map a couple of years ago, and we did a display that marked the anniversary of the first Sydney to Hobart yacht race. I had no idea that Jack was the artist. So it was a really nice discovery to see that, you know, the man who, you know, he really was a very talented graphic artist, and it's a stunning map. The Kathleen Gillett didn't win in the race; it came fourth, but it proved that at the ship, because it's a very rough, it's a very tough voyage down to Hobart, and it proved that she was, you know, sufficiently ocean going to take the trip. So, as I say, the family, it was a very tough decision for them. And once they'd made the decision, they really only had 8 weeks to get ready, to get the boat ready to depart. I did just want to show you this slide, because this is the only way you get to see all 12 covers of the logbook together, because we haven't put them all on display. There wasn't sufficient space in the gallery. And so I just think it's a treat to see them all together. And you do get a sense of the fact that this project, it was a very personal project of preparing the logbooks, was really for Kathleen. And some of the iconography, I think, you know, just the little hearts that he uses. And what was very interesting to me was the two stars. When we were doing some promotion for there was a news story in the paper. The granddaughter of Jack Earl and Kathleen came in to be interviewed. And she told me that the two stars were actually symbols for Jack and Kathleen. They were those sort of navigational stars. They would always, you know, come back to each other, because the pair of stars would lead them back to each other. So, you know, when you look closely into the images, you'll often see that the stars are there. I think in almost every one of the covers, the two stars are there, as well as oft little fond messages. And I just think it's extraordinary, these sort of very stylized images of Kathleen. It's almost hard to get a real sense of what she looked like, because I think she was this very idealized creature for Jack, almost unearthly. But she was incredibly glamorous. I think you can see from the previous photos, you know, she had a look of, to me, she looks a lot like Jane Russell, you know, the movie star. So you can imagine why Jack was bowled over, and he was, you know, very much your sort of swashbuckling, almost Humphrey Bogart-esque kind of character. So they were a real, real glamour couple. So as I say, with only a very short time to get the boat ready, they were ready, finally ready to depart in 1947. And I love this little note, which is on the front of the first logbook. And it says, "Kathleen, this is the first of a series I hope to complete for you, covering various stages of our voyage. May it compensate a little for the joy, terrific effort and love you have contributed." So, and this is really, it's a gift of love to Kathleen all the way through. And you can see the photograph that he has here of her, very fond image. And there was also a beautiful painting of Kathleen by Jack that was hung in the on the boat as well. This was the actual departure from Sydney Harbour. There was a lot of, thousands of people came out to farewell them. It was a media event. You can see there's a newspaper article there, lots of photographs taken. And I love these sort of very glamorous shots of the, you know, the passionate farewell of the sailor as he heads off on his epic voyage. The cartoon on the left is by Unc White. So it would have been a contemporary, another graphic artist, very well known in Sydney, who's done this little tribute to Jack for the voyage. And fantastic image, of course, of a flotilla of boats farewelling them on Sydney Harbour with the bridge behind. So the voyage sets out. There was a plan that Kathleen and the children would actually take a train up to the first port of call, which was on Thursday Island. So the boys just, you know, took off. There were four crew. It was Don Angus, Mick, whose name I'm going to forget. I'm sorry, his last name. Jack Day, and I am going to forget the other man's name too, which is absolutely terrible. He was only on the trip for a short time. The men needed to be quite young. So Jack was quite a lot older than the others because the boat, it was quite a rugged voyage that they were taking. And the other young man, who was not a very experienced sailor, was seasick from the moment they got outside of Sydney Heads. And by the time he got to Queensland, he knew there was no way he was going to make it all the way around the world. So he left the boat. And they were one man short traveling from Queensland to South Africa before they picked up their substitute crewman. But all through, beyond these stunning maritime scenes, this one is actually painted in oil on a very thin board of the Kathleen Gillett in full sail. There are these really lovely little watercolours of different scenic views, little landscape views, and also caricatures, these really fun sketches. So you can imagine the children being really tickled to see images of what was, you know, flipping the pancakes for breakfast. And then also these absolutely stunning drawings of animals and different people and vegetation that the crew encountered along the way. Another thing that you see in the logbooks is stamps. You know, anything that added a little bit of colour or a bit of interest. He documented all of the activities on board. I love this drawing down here, which is showing the technique managing the tiller, just sort of sitting up on deck, because they had to man the boat 24 hours a day, seven days a week when they were sailing. So of course you had to, you know, manage to do that without too much, you know, stress. And then at the top we have the navigator, who was Mick. He was Don was the navigator, and Mick was the man who managed all the sails. And then a cute little drawing down the bottom, just a bit of salacious, indicating that Jack Day, he is obviously not writing to his grandma. So, you know, blokes together on board ship, you can imagine. One of the other things, there's just so many beautiful images in the logbooks. But one of the traditions that that they undertook was that they announced their arrival and departure from each port by blowing into the conch, this incredible conch shell, which had actually been owned by Jack's father. Jack's father had been an administrator in the Torres Strait, and he had acquired this beautiful conch shell in while he was up there. So this conch shell travelled the world and was used to, as I say, announce the arrival and departure in each port of call. So as I say, you know, all throughout we see the iconography of the little stars and the hearts and little, you know, just little mentions and dedications to Kathleen right throughout the logbooks. I like these two images because this is a portrait of Jack down on the right and Kathleen. So nice to have the couple together in this page opening. Oh, and the little, don't you love that little sketch over on the right? Obviously somebody's had a bit of a rough trot, pardon the pun, and they're having to use, make use of emergency latrine system on the boat. And as I say, we've seen already seen that Jack was, you know, quite a talented cartographer. So he was able to create these beautiful maps and charts of the, you know, plotting the voyage of the Kathleen. This one shows that the boat actually left Sydney. It travelled up to Thursday Island, then traversed the Indian Ocean via Reunion, Cocos Islands, Mauritius, and then to South Africa. And, you know, you can see down there, see the little envelope where it says a personal letter to Kathleen. One of the requests of the family was that these not be opened because they were personal messages between Jack and Kathleen. The family had always respected their privacy and hadn't opened the letters, so they did request that the library honour that. And, of course, we're only too pleased to do that. So visiting the Cocos Islands was, you know, obviously a very interesting experience. It was like its own little kingdom. And as I've said, Jack often picked up little souvenirs and added them to the log. And this is the little piece of currency that he included. And you can see it's got the crest of the Clunies Ross family, who basically owned the island. And then this is the date and the quantity of the currency. I don't really understand it, so I'm sorry, I can't explain more. But I thought you might like to see that since we can do this so up close and personal. And it was tucked away in that little envelope that you can see up there. And this was the young heir apparent of the Clunies Ross empire, shall we say, on the Cocos Islands, which they visited in September. So they arrived there in September. Another, I think what I like about this is the idea of the passing of time and Jack being homesick and, you know, looking out into the sky in the morning and also at night and thinking of home, thinking of his family. And again, we have another of those really lovely little personal notes tucked in there just for Kathleen's eyes only. When the boat arrived in port, there were often you know, ongoing repairs that needed to be done. She was a really quite a beautiful vessel, and so they were very keen to keep her in tip-top condition because there really wasn't anything to rescue them if they were out at sea. She needed to be as seaworthy as possible. And also there's that lovely little photograph down in the left-hand corner, which you can see Jack's actually working away on the logbooks in that photo there. And here are just more of the items of paper ephemera. So just telegrams, anything that would give a sense of what had happened, people they'd encountered, the events, little tickets and cables that they'd received. And again, these amazing arrangements of stamps, just as, you know, a normal tourist would do. You can sort of imagine the family being so delighted to see all of this once they got home. And they really did attract a lot of attention. People would, you know, once they heard that a new logbook had been sent back, because Jack would send them back from each port of call. You know, people would rush around to see what had been included. I like this photo because, again, it shows you the crew. This is before they're joined by their fourth crew man, another Jack in Durban in South Africa. And again, you know, the alcohol, like typical men together, they're having a bit of a tipple at the end of the day. They've got their favourites there, the Gordon's gin, and I think any brand of gin seems to be acceptable on that lot, and, of course, the beer. On arriving in Africa, Jack did take the time to create these striking portraits. The young woman on the left apparently had taken some coaxing to allow Jack to create this portrait of her. She was quite suspicious of him. And then this extraordinary documentation of this young Benyan is his name, man, African man on the right. All through, as I've said, Jack took time to express his ongoing devotion to Kathleen. This is actually a card he drew for their anniversary. And you can see that, you know, he's a man who's missing his wife, definitely. And lovely little message there. And this was the card that he did for her birthday. You know, very happy birthday, my beautiful little love. Jack had actually had probably quite suffered from dyslexia. So you can see the very has actually got two R's in it, and he was a pretty bad speller. So while they were off the coast of Africa, they had Christmas. So Christmas Day was actually spent on board. They had to keep the boat sailing. Obviously, someone had to stay on watch at various times, but they were able to have a time together, a drink together. It shows you it was quite a warm and friendly, you know, they really made it fun. They went to a lot of trouble to create a Christmas dinner. You can see the Christmas pudding is there. They talk a lot. The boat was wasn't actually very well kitted out, but they didn't realise that the gas bottles in the kitchen could actually have exploded at any time when they were on the voyage. It was actually quite unsafe. Whenever they were on land, they also took every opportunity to go around and to see what was happening. This is the island of Saint Helena, where Napoleon is buried, and this image here shows you the burial site with the little fencing around. And also Jack has done this gorgeous drawing of the message on the tombstone and the gentleman who the consul that they worked with on the island. He also took a lot of time to document native life, the wildlife that they encountered. And of course, there were some extraordinary things that they saw. This incredible iguana from the Galapagos, you know, this huge lobster, an enormous tortoise that was also on the Galapagos, and then just a plethora of wildlife that they encountered. And the seals, I just love that, the drawing of the seals, as well as the little kiwi that they encountered in New Zealand. So having been to Africa, they then came round the Cape of Cape Town. They headed across to St. Helena, as we've seen, to the Ascension Islands, and their next stop was Brazil. And he marks here very very much the halfway round the world, and the fact that he's opposite Mossman Bay. So again, as ever, thinking of home and thinking of his family. And I love this. This, I think, has to be one of my favourite images because, again, it's Jack painting himself up on deck and showing just no matter how far he is, his thoughts are constantly around you. There is no abandoned freedom here. You hold my heart, beloved. Just an extraordinary. Imagine being the person receiving all of these very fond tributes. So arriving in Brazil, it was Mardi Gras, carnival time. So the boys, of course, took every opportunity to go inland, to explore, and also take part in the festivities. This is the crew. This is where we really get to see. So Mick Morris, Will Sinclair, Jack Day and Don Angus. There you are. And I love this group of little sketches that just captures many, so many of those little day-to-day activities and, you know, bathing, doing the chores, you know, obviously manning the tiller, which was a huge responsibility. You can see there's a lot more images of manning the tiller than anything else. Playing an instrument, just trying to keep amused on very, very long days. The naked lying down with the book on the sail, getting a bit of a tan, an all over tan. And a few more are down the side here. This is the navigator using his sextant, writing to friends home, doing the washing up, you know, sleeping, resting, making dinner, just all those chores, the everyday life of the sailors on board. Heading to the Caribbean, this is where whenever they visited any port of call, they were always feted by the local officials, and they had a great time, you know, hanging out with all the rough types and the knockabouts on the, you know, that would inhabit the wharfs of the ports. But when they got to Jamaica, they encountered a celebrity. So Errol Flynn, of course, Australian movie star Errol Flynn, he had a house on Jamaica and was a sailor as well. And so they spent, I think, quite a fun time, rousing time with Errol Flynn. So a nice brush with fame to add to the story. And I love these images showing you just the hard graft of sailing the boat. The Kathleen was a very Spartan vessel. There was no electricity. There was no hydraulics. There was nothing to actually help in the sailing of the vessel. It was all done with human effort. And this really shows you as they're pulling in the spinnaker in a heavy wind. But then the joy is something of like this, being surrounded by hundreds of porpoises that just sort of emerged in the ocean as they were, you know, sailing along. Extraordinary. They had a few brushes with danger as well. At one point, this tanker just came out of the glooming and nearly knocked them out. There was some damage to the boat, and they had to be tugged into port. And they were nearly swamped by the wash from the tug. It wasn't wasn't very well driven. Sorry, I'm not a very maritime person, so I have to pardon my lesson specialised language. And I love this little image of Will Sinclair. Will was the crewman that they picked up in Durban in South Africa, and he was a photographer. So he took a lot of the photographs that you see in the logbooks, and you can see this in this little caricature where he sort of had to clamber up high to get the shot that you can see there of the boat at the wharf that's being, he's climbed up very high to be able to get that shot. They are traveling through the Caribbean, further through the Caribbean. And there were some, you know, I think good nights that were had by not all the boys were attached. And one night they went to a nightclub. They were told that there was this fantastic nightclub that they should go to. And this is Jack's rendition of the nightclub dancer. The men were sitting, you know, in their booth, and all of a sudden they were surrounded by ladies of the night who kept plying them with alcohol. And as he says to Kathleen, oh, you can be sure that, you know, we all got home back to the boat, you know, nobody strayed away. And then on their departure from Kingston, they were given this wonderful send-off by the yacht club, the Kingston Yacht Club. Heading through the Panama Canal, they were, you know, coming to be, you know, heading into the Pacific. And so they took time out to actually toast the Pacific, knowing that, you know, they were on their last legs home. And having spent some time, about 2 years in America, and I remember very much getting to the West Coast and seeing the ocean, and there is something very powerful about that sight, I think, for Australians when you've been away for some time to get that sense that just on the other side of all that water is home. This is the cover of the logbook 10, and just the detail that has been put into this this image, showing you all the soundings. So this is a very different type of map that Jack has created, and of course, front and center to it all is Kathleen and the two guiding stars. So traveling through the Pacific was an opportunity to visit some wonderful islands, again, to encounter the local culture and to just take advantage of every opportunity to explore new horizons. By the time they arrived in New Zealand, you would think that the worst of the trip was over, but it actually took them quite a long time to get home. They had to spend time again scraping the bottom of the boat and, you know, getting her ready, seaworthy, because the trip across the Tasman is you know, very challenging. And in fact, it was once they had set sail in a gale force, they actually lost the spinnaker, which it's the jib, not the spinnaker. And they were very glad that that had not happened earlier in the voyage, because it would have been quite difficult. And as it was Mick Morris that was in charge of all the sails. And as Jack says, I think it's in, yes, yeah, so you can see Mick there in the centre, stitching away and making sure that the sails are in tip-top shape. And in the caption, it says that Kathleen achieved amazing speed, 3,000 miles an hour. And really, this was due to the effort and the dedication of Mick in keeping the sails in excellent order and always making sure that they didn't suffer any delays. And here again, we have Don Angus with his... or is it Mick? I keep getting confused. Sorry. Yes, it is Mick. I apologise. With his sextant doing the navigation work. Mick was also the one that he wrote the stories for the Seacraft magazine, because there was no money. That they none of them had any money. Two of the crew members had literally no money. Will, when they picked him up in South Africa, had not a cent to his name. So they were actually giving him a trip. He was working his way back to Australia as a crew member. And but to make ends meet, Mick and Jack prepared articles for the Seacraft magazine. I'm going to sneeze. Oh, pardon me. I hope that's it. I think that's it. Oh dear, where did that come from? Mick would do the text and Jack would do the images. So colour images as well as the sketches. And really, I didn't have time to go through the magazines terribly closely when I was preparing the Amaze display, but I have had time since. And here's just an example of one of the articles. There were over 20 articles that appeared throughout the 18-month journey around the world. And I'd say 90% of the images that are in the logbooks actually are reproduced in the Seacraft magazines. So it is actually possible to get extended understanding of the voyage through Seacraft. Unfortunately, it's not digitized, but if people are keen enough to follow, they can certainly do that. As I say, Jack was not a particularly well-educated man because of his dyslexia, but he, I think he used a lot of the basis of what Mick had prepared for the articles to sort of construct the text, the handwritten text that we see, though of course he always had a personal angle to add to the story. Well, the voyage was coming to a close. They finally managed to get across the Tasman, and finally they saw land there. And you can see in this little sketch on the side their delight at actually seeing the edge of Australia and knowing that they were making it home, they made it around the world. It was exactly 18 months. They'd left in June and they returned in December. There were, as again, thousands of people turned out to meet them. Kathleen and the other Mick's wife had been, looking for them, on the lookout for them for a week or so. Kathleen actually missed the news that they had arrived, and so she and Jack actually decided to keep their reunion private. She didn't go down to meet the boat straight away. She waited until all the press had gone away before she went to see him. So back home and reunited, and I just love that, so the last entry is just 18 months since we left, 28,700 miles in seven months. I don't know what that says. Sorry. I can't see it. In ports. So, beloved, this is the last entry in the book and the start of our lives together again. Thank you again for waiting, Peerless Heart. And he did call her Heart. That was his name for her. So once the family were reunited, the plan was that they would, they needed to build a home because it really wasn't possible for them to live on the boat any longer. So within a couple of years, in 1950, they did sell the Kathleen Gillett because they wanted to build their home, which they did subsequently in Mossman. But they did have other boats. The Maris, which is still owned or still sailed by the Earl's granddaughter today. And it was planned that there are twin granddaughters, and there are four grandchildren altogether. They are the children of Maris. They had planned to sail in last year's Sydney to Hobart race, but unfortunately it was cancelled. But the couple did continue to have a life in boats, even though the Kathleen Gillett was sold away. And they continued to travel all their lives. Kathleen passed away in the 1980s, but Jack was always, totally dedicated to her memory. His granddaughter said that on their special days, and there were many special days, she said, he would always sit down, get two drinks, one each, even though she was not there, and why not have, he might as well have hers too. He would go to their chairs and sit down and wait till the appointed time and then have quiet time to toast to his beloved Kathleen. I was also told that in another part of the collection, I think we saw in this presentation, two of the cards that Jack made, the anniversary card and the birthday card. And apparently this was a tradition throughout their married life. And there are over 400 cards that were exchanged between them that are in the library's collection. So that's another treat for me that I'm going to be able to go and discover some extraordinary, I'm sure, really extraordinary artworks that are in the collection there. So in just wrapping up, the Kathleen Gillett, as I say, was sold, and she went off to have quite an exciting time. She was working as a crocodile hunting vessel up in far north Queensland, and had quite a checkered career until she was sort of stripped and left abandoned pretty much in Guam. And it was there that prior to the bicentenary, a bid was made to the Norwegian government, and it was suggested that this could be a fantastic gift to the people of Australia to find and restore the Kathleen Gillett and donate it to the National Maritime Museum. So this was done, it was agreed to, and the work was all done by Halvorsens, of course, another Norwegian firm located in Sydney, and they spent, a long time crafting and really lovingly restoring the Kathleen Gillett. She was donated to the Maritime Museum, and she's actually floating in Darling Harbour. And you can actually book and go on board and visit the boat. For a while during COVID, that wasn't possible, but I'm not sure whether it is possible now. But it's something that I think I'm going to put on my agenda. I think I'd love to go and see where all of these adventures took place. And in just in a final note, I do have a couple of the pages of the logbook, which I thought you might like to see. You can see they're quite large. So the on beautiful sheets of art paper, and just, you know, I think the fact that Jack was a graphic artist meant that, you know, he had that capability to do all the beautiful lettering. This is one of the charts, that stunning chart of the Indian Ocean. Just beautiful detail. Just me. I'm not very good at geography, and I must say, having those aids really helped in understanding how the voyage unfolded. Well, I think that's where I'll wrap up. It's been a wonderful time to take you on this trip around the world with Jack and his crew, and Kathleen waiting faithfully at home. I hope you've enjoyed it, and I don't know that we have any questions. No. Okay. Well, I hope you enjoy the rest of your day, and you might take the chance to come into the State Library and see a selection of the logbooks on display in the Amaze Gallery. They'll be up until, I think it's August. And alternatively, if you want to, there's a web story on the Library website, and you can actually look at the logbooks, which have been fully digitized through the link on the web story. So thank you for joining me today, and we hope to see you soon.